Hi students, I am Dr. M. Ashraf Majru, Professor of Community Medicine. I welcome you in the learning session of Water Quality Management and Water Quality Standards. This is the first lecture of Water and Sanitation series. Let us discuss the highlights. The highlights of this session are the Sustainable Development Goal 6 and its targets, accessibility to safe drinking water, health hazards of unsafe water, water quality management stakeholders, water quality standards and indicators, surveillance and monitoring of public water supplies. Now we will discuss the highlights one by one. The Sustainable Development Goal 6 indicates the priority agenda. The water is a serious issue, global issue. It is kept in the agenda of Sustainable Development Goal. The goal is defined as everyone on the earth should have access to safe and affordable drinking water up to 2030. So this is the goal, SGD 6. Now what is the situation and what is the fact sheet at this moment? The water scarcity affects more than 40% of the people around the world, and that number is projected to go even higher as a result of climatic changes. Globally, at least 2 billion people use drinking water sources contaminated with feces. By 2025, half of the world population will be living in water stress areas. Contaminated water can transmit diseases such as diarrhea, cholera, dysentery, typhoid, and polio, and so many other diseases. Now, what are the targets related to the Sustainable Development Goal 6? The target 6.1 states that universal and equitable access to safe and affordable drinking water for all. So, this is the target 6.1, that is the universal access to safe drinking water. Now, and the Sustainable Development Goal are also dealing with the underlying factors to achieve the goals and targets, and how these underlying factors will be addressed. And they are the target. They are targeted under 6.3 agenda. The improved water quality by reducing pollution, elimination of dumping of water, minimizing release of hazardous chemicals and materials, halving the proportion of untreated wastewater, substantial increase in recycling and safe reuse of water. So these are the targets under the Sustainable Development Goal 6. Now, what is the safe and wholesome water? A safe water is one that does not harm the consumer. That is the safe. And what is wholesome? The supply which is acceptable to consumer is defined as a wholesome or potable water. Now, these both qualities must be present in safe and wholesome water. And further we elaborate, and the wholesome and safe water is defined as water that is free from pathogens, free from harmful chemical substances, pleasant to taste, can be used for drinking and other domestic purpose. So this is the elaboration of what is safe and wholesome water. Then, indicator for safe water supplies. The proportion of household having access to safe, portable and convenient source of drinking water. And the piped water supply within the dwelling will be taken as safe water supply. Hand pump or motorized pump within dwelling is taken as safe water supply. And more or less rest of the sources are treated as unsafe until and unless they are protected. So if they are protected, then they can be included into the safe water supply. Now let us discuss the accessibility to safe drinking water. The WHO has defined certain terms related to water, and first, what is drinking water? Drinking water means the water used for domestic purpose, drinking, cooking, and personal hygiene. Then the geographical access. The geographical access is defined by WHO that the source less than 1 kilometer away from the place of use, and it is possible to reliably obtain at least 20 liter per member of household per day. So this is the geographical access to the drinking water. Then what is safe drinking water? Water with microbial, chemical, and physical characteristic that meet the WHO guideline are national standards are of drinking water. So they should meet the WHO guideline. WHO issue its guideline by its regions and globally, and then the countries, they establish their own standards of drinking water supply. So either the country water standard should be met or the WHO guideline must be met. Then access to safe drinking water. The proportion of people using improved drinking water sources, household connections, public piped supplies, protected well, protected spring and rain water. Again, it is stressed that if it is well or spring or rain water, they must be protected, and then they will be included into the access to safe drinking water. Now, the accessibility to safe drinking water, access to safe drinking water is measured by the percentage of the population using improved drinking water sources. Now, what is improved and unimproved drinking water sources? Improved drinking water sources by its nature of construction able to protect outside contamination, especially the contamination of the feces. So, what are these sources? The piped household water connection, the public standpipe, the borehole, commonly known as tube wells, protected dug well, and protected spring, protected rainwater collections. So these are the improved safe drinking waters sources. Then what are unimproved? Unimproved water sources unable to protect outside contamination, especially the fecal contamination. These are unprotected dug well, unprotected spring, surface water like river, dam, lake, pond, stream, canal, irrigation channels, the vendor provided water through carts and small tank and drums, they are also unprotected. Tank, truck water, they are also included unprotected or unsafe water sources. Here it is to be mentioned, these are the declared unsafe water sources, but if the dug well, spring and rain water collection, they are not protected, then they will be also treated unsafe. And these sources, they are included, usually included in the safe water supplies. Now, what is the current situation of and drinking household using improved water sources, drinking water sources in Pakistan. In Pakistan, overall 92.6% of the population have access to improved sources of drinking water. And in urban-rural split, in urban, 93.8% have access to improved sources, and in rural, 91.9% have access to safe drinking water. While we are talking about the percentage using improved sources of drinking water by provinces or regions, the Balochistan have least is the lowest, that is 75.3% access, and then KP northern Malakand areas 81%, and overall KP other regions 92%. And Gilgit-Baltistan 94.2%. Similarly, in AJK 80.9%. Punjab has the highest water supply, rich water supply, that is 95.9% in the Punjab. In Islamabad territory, 94.9%. People have access to improved sources of water. As we have plenty of access to improved sources of water, but on the other hand, we have highest level of water contaminations. So what is the level of contamination? The coliform household drinking water contamination is more as compared to the E. coli contamination. And the coliform in Pakistan 56.1% contamination, water sources are contaminated, fecal contaminated. And then 54% in urban and 57% in rural areas. The rural area have relatively more contamination as compared to the urban area, the coliform contamination. On the other hand, the E. coli contamination is overall 36% in Pakistan and 37% in urban areas and 35% in rural areas. So the E. coli contamination is more in the urban areas as compared into the rural areas. So the water improved to water supply to improved sources is encouraging, but on the other hand, the water contamination is a real problem in Pakistan. The highest prevalence of E. coli contamination is in KP, northern Malakand VN 78.3% and lowest in Punjab 30.4%. Now the health hazards related to unsafe water use. There are biological and chemical hazards related to water. The biological hazards are viral, like viral hepatitis A, poliomyelitis, rotavirus, and other viruses that cause the diarrhea. Then bacterial contamination leads to cholera, typhoid, bacillary dysentery, E. coli diarrhea. Protozoal, amoebiasis, and giardiasis, helminthetics. The roundworm, whipworm, threadworm, and hydrated disease, they are the helminthic diseases. The leptospirosis, Weil's disease, is transmitted by animal urine contamination of water and soil, and it is very common. The cyclope is a vector host for the guinea worm disease and the fish tapeworm, and snail is the vector and the host for the schistosomiasis. So these are the biological hazards related to water, and then chemical hazards like detergents and solvents, heavy metals like arsenic, lead, iron, copper, they are causing the metal poisoning, heavy metal poisoning, mineral and organic acids, nitrogenous substances, then bleaching agents, dyes and pigments, sulfides, cyanides, ammonia compounds. All these chemicals are present in the water and cause health hazards. All chemical substances may lead to acute and chronic poisoning. Then water quality management. How we manage the quality of water? The water quality management is a multi-sectoral approach. It is multiple sectors should be involved in the water quality management. There are government and non-government agencies and stakeholders in water quality management. The main stakeholder is the government, and the responsibility of government is the legislation on safe water supply and ensuring accessibility of safe water supply to the masses. Then public health engineering technical expert agency responsible for safe water and its maintenance. This is the engineering department related to water supply. Then health authorities setting the water quality standards and monitoring those standards and statistical data and research on water health hazards. These are the responsibilities. Moreover, the water the sampling and surveillance of water sources is also in the domain of health authorities. Then community awareness and education regarding use of safe water and how to care the water supplies. This is the responsibility of the community. The international health agencies and non-government organizations, the facilitation of safe water and sanitation to low-income and deprived nations. WHO goal for universal access to safe water is the example of the international responsibilities. The health authority, we will focus more what are the main key responsibilities of health authorities in relation to water quality management. So let us discuss the approach to the water quality management. The approach is the setting quality standards and then making legislation and regulation and then promulgation of those legislation related to water quality, and then monitoring and surveillance of the water sources and sampling, and then taking action pleading the litigations related to water monitoring services. So this is the framework through which the water quality is managed. Now let us discuss what are the standards. The standards setting standards. The setting standards defines the establishing the list of regulated contaminants. Then maximum contaminant levels, they are regulated items and they are fixed through the water quality standards. It is important to learn what is how we define the contaminant levels, the maximum contaminant levels. The maximum contaminant level is defined as the level at which the person could drink 2 liters of water containing the contaminant every day for 70 years without suffering ill effect is known as the maximum contaminant level. And here it should be reminded that for the known carcinogens, health goal is at zero. the contaminant must be at zero under the assumption that the exposure to the chemical could present a cancer risk. So these are the standards. Maximum contaminant levels, they must be fixed through the standards. Moreover, in standards, set water testing schedule and methods that water system must follow. This is also in the standards. The list of acceptable technique for treating the contaminated water is also in the suggestion of the standards. So this is the first step in water quality management, setting the standards. Regarding standards, WHO issue its standards and guideline time to time, and they have developed the regional guidelines and the global guidelines, and the nations or the countries, they can set their own guidelines in line with the WHO guidelines. And the guidelines speak about the microbial criteria, toxic chemical substances, specific substances affecting the health, then acceptability characteristics of the water, radioactive substances, limits. And these are all decided in the standards, and WHO has already given the guidelines related to these standards. Now, the water quality indicators are divided into physical indicators, biological and chemical and radiological indicators. In physical indicators, we talk about the turbidity, color, odor and taste, temperature and pH of the water. In biological standards, we estimate the microbial counts for coliform and E. coli. These are the indicators. These counts will decide whether the water is microbially free, safe or unsafe. Then chemical routine, chemical substances which are due to the decomposition of organic matters in the water. And then special chemical substances and heavy metals, their levels, they are included in the chemical indicators. We will discuss these indicators. Then radioactive contaminations levels. Now we will discuss one by one all the indicators and their safe containment levels. And the first, the physical quality standards. In physical quality standards, the indicators are turbidity, color, odor and taste, temperature and pH. Now the acceptable levels for turbidity must be less than 5 nephelometric turbidity units, commonly abbreviated as NTU. Then color up to 15 true color units, abbreviated as TCU, is acceptable. Odor and taste, an unusual taste and odor might be indicator of presence of harmful substances. Then temperature, no guideline is recommended for high temperature. However, the high temperature enhances the growth of microorganisms. pH, the acceptable pH of drinking water is between 6.5 to 8.5. So these are the physical quality standards, and usually they are tested in the field. Then microbial criteria is very important indicator. Ideally, all samples taken from distribution system should be free from coliform organism. Or throughout any year, 95% of the sample should not contain any coliform organism in 100 ml. The other criteria, no sample should contain any E. coli in 100 ml. This is ideal. No sample should contain more than 3 coliform organisms per 100 ml. The more criterion, the coliform organism should not be detectable in 100 ml of any 2 consecutive samples. The fecal bacteriophage and the enteropathogenic viruses should be completely absent from the water. So this is the microbial criteria indicators which are able to, through which we can decide the safety, microbial safety of water. Then moving to chemical water quality standards. The usual chemicals in the water which are present are the chlorides, hardness, saline ammonia, albuminide ammonia, nitrites, nitrates, oxygen absorbed and dissolved oxygens. The acceptable standards, not less than 200 milligram per liter. All water contain chloride, but excess of chlorine is indicator of salinity of water. Hardness not more than 300 milligram per liter, and the value near 150 milligram are generally ideal from an aesthetic point of view, but it poses no health concern. The use of detergent is increased with the increase of hardness, but health effects are not reported with the hardness. Saline ammonia not more than 0.05 milligram per liter. It is the indicator of recent sewage contamination. Albuminide ammonia should not be more than 0.1 milligram per liter. It is the indicator of unoxidized organic matter in the water. Nitrites must be zero. It is the indicator of water pollution of recent origin if it is present. Nitrites are not more than 1 milligram per liter, and they show the past sewage contamination. Oxygen absorbed not more than 1 milligram per liter. It is the indicator of amount of organic matter present in the water. The dissolved oxygen not less than 5 milligram per liter. Depletion of dissolved oxygen indicate the conversion of nitrites to nitrates. Then more the toxic chemical substances, generally heavy metals, and the goals the national goals are relatively higher than the ideal goal set by WHO. The arsenic 0.05 milligram per liter, cadmium 0.005 milligram per liter, cyanide 0.05 milligram per liter, lead 0.05, mercury 0.001, and selenium 0.01. Ideally, they must be zero, but this is if the goal is not achieved, this is the requirement to be achieved for treating the water as consumable water. The highest level of contamination that is allowed in drinking water is the maximum contaminant level, are set as closer to the maximum contaminant level goals, are feasible using the best available treatment technology and taking cost into consideration. MCLs are enforceable standards. Then specific chemical substances, fluoride 0.5 to 0.8 milligram is the safe limit. Excess will cause the fluorosis and deficiency will lead to dental caries. Nitrates 45 milligram per liter excess will lead to infantile methemoglobinemia. Aromatic hydrocarbons must not exceed 0.2 microgram per liter. Then radiological water quality standards, the alpha particles 50 picocuries per liter, more than that will increase the risk of cancer, beta particle 4 millirams per year, and exceeding will increase the cancer, risks of cancer. Radium should not be more than 5 picocuries per liter, and it will increase the risk of cancer. The uranium 30 microgram per liter increase the risk of cancer and kidney toxicity. So these are the radiological quality standards, and here it is reminded these are the standards set by the government of Pakistan. Then surveillance and monitoring of public water supply is very important in water supply management. The steps, the surveillance and monitoring steps for public water supply include the collection of water samples, then transport of samples, and water quality testing. The collection of sample, we use the specific containers and preservative for sampling at various water sources. And then the transport to specific in specific boxes with maintenance of cold chain and temperature maintenance. Water quality testing, all areas, physical, microbiological, chemical, and radiological testing are recommended in water quality. And these three steps must be followed. Now, and the water sampling is done from the dug well, borehole supplies, like tube well supplies, and then municipal mains, water tanks and reservoirs, springs, and surface water. All consumable water sources, the sampling is done with the agreed schedule. The sample is transported in specific boxes, and the boxes must have a layer of insulation material and ice packs to maintain, or the ice mixture to maintain the temperature cold chain. The samples are then arranged into the cold box and then transported to the lab for the analysis. Along with this box, there must be a bottle lab labels, essential information to be labeled and coded. That is the locality, sample site, place, source, residual chlorine, date of sampling, time of sampling, and the sender. These are the essential information on the bottles. Then data collection form must be there. The data collection form must consist of the information like sampling date, locality, sample size, place, source, sender, date of collection, and time of collection. Then at the same time, the analysis sheet must be there. That should indicate the time of analysis, residual chlorine, and the other results of the tested sample. Then some of the testings, they are done in the field. These includes the alkalinity, hardness, total residual bromine, chloramines, free residual chlorine, total residual chlorine, pH, and temperature. These parameters, they are tested in the field, and preservative, usually no preservative is required in the field testing, and the container that can be used, they are polythene or plastic, sterilized plastic and glass bottles. For all these purposes, these bottles either polythene plastic or glass bottles, they can be used. Then 10 ml water is usually required, except for temperature where the 125 ml water is required, and the time between sample collection and analysis is in the field testing is usually 30 minutes for most of the parameters. But it is more and it is for pH it is 2 hours, and it is minimum for temperature, that is 3 minutes. The rest of the things like alkalinity, hardness and residual chlorines, they are tested within the 30 minutes in the field testing. Then the preservatives, they are for coliform sodium thiosulfate, and these are the container, and 100 ml water is required, and the time between sample collection and analysis must not exceed 48 hours. For fecal coliform, fecal E. coli, Pseudomonas, Aeruginosa, and Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus aureus, for all these samples, the sodium thiosulfate is the preservative. For turbidity, note nothing is required as preservative, and 125 ml water, and it should be tested within. These are the lab tests for the water. Then in conclusion, the availability and accessibility to safe drinking water is priority health issue and kept in the agenda of Sustainable Development Goal 6 for 2030. As setting water quality standard and implementation through legislation is essential for safe water supply. Water sampling and transport for analysis is essential public health skill for water quality monitoring. So this is for all in this session, and thank you very much for listening.